You guys are in from New York City.
We are. We've been in LA for 3 months.
3 months?
3 months, yeah.
So are you doing, are you working?
Well, I mean, do you want to explain why we're here?
I'm here. I have a museum scholar residency at the Getty for 3 months because I'm writing a biography of a man named Sam Wagstaff, who is the lover and mentor of Robert Mapplethorpe.
Yes.
And then some. And Richard is here kind of developing his next project.
So, okay, now this is completely off of your movie. However, is the Getty going to do something on Wagstaff, or is it doing something on Wagstaff?
Well, the Getty is not, but I'm writing a biography for Norton, and the Getty holds all of Sam's papers. Huh. And I was invited to come as a museum scholar for 3 months to work on my biography.
And they're putting us up, basically. They're putting us up in an apartment, and we thought it was a great opportunity to be out here, and I can work on my next movie, and Philip can write his book and do his research there. And
so they don't put you up in the house on the hill overlooking Malibu.
It's in an apartment on Sunset.
It's an apartment complex.
It's great. It's great.
For scholars at the Getty.
It would actually be really nice if the Getty did a Wagstaff thing because they would actually liven the place up a bit.
Well, in fact,
he's actually doing
in fact, there. I mean, well, it's a long story that I don't necessarily want to go into right now. But there are projects afoot.
Excellent.
I'll leave it at that.
So we were talking before, and you guys are actually married. Are you legally married now?
Finally? Legally married.
Well, legally married in New York.
In the state of New York.
Well, we got married in San Francisco.
In San Francisco, yeah.
In 2008. Uh-huh. In the window in which it still is valid. And then New York State honored marriages outside of New York State. And so we are legally married.
Excellent. So is the Wagstaff, obviously, with Mapplethorpe. I don't know about Bill Cunningham, but is the gay theme a part of the work? Is it something you guys are actually particularly interested in, or is it just coincidental?
No.
That.
No, I mean, I think that Sam is a separate thing, and
and
Bill came out of something completely separate from anything about sexuality or anything.
Right.
You know.
I'm sorry. Just to address that question, it's the gay theme is not something that I'm particularly interested in.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I am also interested in, but I wrote about photography for the New York Times for some years, and Sam was one of the earliest and most important photography collectors, whose collection was sold to the Getty in 1984, which forms the foundation of their collection of photographs, which is among the top three museum collections in the world. Mm-hmm. So to that extent, that's why I'm interested in Sam.
Right.
The fact that he was gay and that Robert was gay is inclusive of what I'm writing about.
Mm-hmm.
But just to go back to Bill, that was not...
It's an apolitical movie. It's not, you know, but it's always interesting when filmmakers are, you know, out, whether that's an issue or not.
Yeah.
I mean, for me, really, you know, I grew up in New York. I grew up reading Bill's column, and I followed it for years as a kid, and never knew anything about him. And really, about 10 years ago, 10 years ago, I was working at the New York Times as an art director, and I actually worked with Bill doing his page. So that's how I met him, and it took 8 years to convince him to let us make a movie about
him. So you wanted to make a movie about him pretty much from the
beginning? Yeah, I mean, as soon as I met him, I thought, this guy is so amazing as a person. So that was really the impetus. You know, I just thought, you know, what he does is really interesting, but really who he is as a person, you know, how he lives his life, his ethics, his obsession with his work, you know, that was really singular. And I went to Philip, who was working at the New York Times, and I said, Bill is amazing. I really want to make a movie about him. So we dragged Bill into a conference room at the New York Times, sat him down, and we said, we want to make a documentary about you. And he just laughed. He just thought it was the most ridiculous, absurd thing. And it took about 8 years to finally convince him.
So it's another strange, as we're on this theme of strange things that actually aren't connected. Page One coming out the same year as this feels almost like a New York Times initiative to promote the paper somehow, but it has nothing to do with
it. It has nothing to do with that.
I mean, the Times had nothing to do with the making of Bill Cunningham in New York. We were making it, and they came in and supported us. They gave us some money for production, but they had nothing to do with the content, or we had total freedom to make the movie. They were just there as a co-producer, and they actually saw the movie when it was finished.
You should tell the story about how it came to be, how we actually brought it to the New York Times. And it was only after I had been an editor for 15 years and I took a buyout in 2008. And it was after the buyout, or right around that time, that Bill was receiving an award in New York City, a living, mm-hmm. is it a Living Legend?
Living Legend Award, yeah.
Award at the Waldorf Astoria. It was a big dinner. Mm-hmm. I was invited to the Times table. They took a table out for 10. Mm-hmm. And I was told that Bill was not interested in receiving the award. He was not going to go on stage and get the award. Mm-hmm. I mentioned this to Richard. Richard says to me, why not put together some of the clips that I had shot 8 years ago of Bill, and mm-hmm. we'll do a little short, and we can use that as a presentation. A great idea. We did that.
Okay, before we keep going, the clips you shot 8 years ago, you just started shooting him? Or?
Well, we had been trying for months to get his cooperation. Uh-huh. And then I realized, maybe, and he is really modest. He's mm-hmm. profoundly shy. The idea that anyone would want to make a movie about him is anathema to him. You know, it's ridiculous. And I thought, you know, maybe he just needs to get used to a camera being around him. So one day I said to him, you know, Bill, if I'm on the street with a camera and I see you, maybe I'll take some footage of you. He's like, oh, child, stop being so ridiculous. And so I went out on the street. I basically stalked him.
This is 2001. You know,
this is 2001. Mm-hmm. And I went on the street and filmed him shooting, you know, people on the street. And he was completely ignoring me, never acknowledged I was there. And as he went to get back on his bike, he looks directly in the camera and he waves me over. I'm like, okay. And he says, you know, come back to the New York Times. You can film me, you know, editing my film and doing my work there. Mm-hmm. So I thought, oh my God, he's agreed to do the movie. So I go back to the New York Times with him and I film for an afternoon. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the day, he says to me, okay, there's your movie. You don't need anything else. So I was like, okay. So I had all this footage from that one day from 2001.
And not a movie.
And not obviously not a movie. So I cut together like a 3-minute, you know, sort of homage to Bill for this award ceremony. Mm-hmm. And we showed it and the Times was there and they really liked it. And Bill actually saw it and he liked it. And so that's when the conversation started between us and the New York Times about partnering.
And did Bill go up or not?
He didn't.
He didn't.
Still didn't go up.
No, well, actually, he did go up. But instead of receiving the award, he started shooting the audience.
He started taking pictures,
so he started taking pictures of the audience, and that's how he dealt with it. Huh. And then, so we brought the idea back to the Times and said, you know, we have this footage. We have been trying for years. Here's a great opportunity. And so they basically kind of agreed. And so they started, they gave us funding to make the movie. And that's how that came to be. They had nothing to do whatsoever with the content of the film. Just that.
So how did you get Bill ultimately to say yes?
Well, here's the joke that was on us. You know, he finally said yes when all those elements came together, when he saw what we had done and he kind of sensed that we got who he was. So we finally agreed in 2008. And so we were totally thrilled, of course. And so I was following him for a week mm-hmm. during Fashion Week in 2008. And I came back the next Monday with the camera, and he said, what are you doing here? And I said, well, what do you mean? You've agreed to make the movie. And he said, well, it can't be more than a week, can it? You know? So it really was a constant negotiation mm-hmm. of getting his cooperation. And it took about a year of begging, pleading, you know, anything possible. I mean, it really felt like I was making some National Geographic film, like hunting this wild exotic creature, because it really was, you know, so much time spent just trying to get his cooperation.
So do you think you were in his way when he was working and you were shooting him?
We had to learn how not to be in his way. And in fact, we had to learn how to read his moods. It would take sometimes 3 weeks to convince him to let us follow him around, like in his evening hours, events. That took a months actually, to convince him to let us follow him around on the bicycle. But at every stage, we had to, you know, we had to be really sensitive to how he worked. For example, you know, at the very beginning, I would say, okay, Bill, I know you're going out to shoot this afternoon. Let us know what time and we'll follow you there. Mm-hmm. And he'd disappear. He would just sneak out. But if we, after several days, we figured out where he usually shoots and we just showed up, mm-hmm. he loved that. And then he would reward us with his cooperation. So
you were training him and he was training him?
If we were as spontaneous as he was, if we just allowed him just the organic flow of his natural activity mm-hmm. And schedule, then he was fine. But if we asked him to do something and it became a conscious kind of ordeal, he would just kind of escape.
And I mean, the thing, the real challenge in the making of the movie was that it was done so unconventionally, just sort of technically, because Bill wouldn't allow a cinematographer that he didn't know. He wouldn't allow a sound person. He wouldn't allow a boom operator. So I ended up shooting the film with Tony Santacola, who was the other cinematographer, who was a great still photographer at the New York Times, who had never shot a movie before, but who Bill knows and trusts. So, and we were doing our own sound. So it was just this kind of like very funky situation, a very funky way to make a movie. I mean, I had never shot my own films. I'd never been my own cinematographer. So there were these challenges just technically, you know, and I was really worried aesthetically, what's it going to look like? And, but in a way, it sort of was the right way to make the movie because there was ultimately an intimacy there that we wouldn't have achieved if there had been a film crew.
So what do you think what do you think his issue was with having different cameramen or whatever? Was it just his personal comfort level, or was it trusting what it would look like, or?
It's just that he so didn't want a movie to be made to begin with, that the only way he would allow it is if he had people who he trusted around him. And the fact is, it didn't even look like a movie was being made because we were using camera mics, and occasionally I can get a lav on him. So, you know, we had these little cameras, and we were just sitting around the New York Times waiting for him to let me turn on the camera. So it was a very low-key kind of thing where it couldn't look like a movie was being made,
right.
And it didn't.
I think it was his comfort level. I mean, it was also that we didn't want to interrupt the natural flow of what he did. And, you know, and he trusted us. I mean, he knew, I've known him since 1992 when I first started working at the Times, and we developed a rapport, and then he developed a rapport with Richard, and he had known Tony from the Times. So it felt like, I mean, you've said this many times, a family affair. And you know, so he did feel comfortable, and he knew that we understood the way he worked. I think he didn't understand that initially, but he got that we respected, you know, the natural flow of his daily activities, and that couldn't have happened if we had more of a crew at all.
So the personal stuff that's not work related, and maybe the nighttime stuff has something to do with that also, but was that much harder? Was it very different in terms of how he responded to you wanting to get that information or shoot that footage?
Well, I think, you know, all of that happened over time. You know, we knew how he lived. We sort of sensed how he lived. We were never in his apartment. And so all of that, you know, the slow revealing of him as a person came over time. And I, in a way, I structured the movie to sort of be the same. The arc of the film is him revealing himself to us in a certain way. So the audience is discovering him the way, in effect, how we discovered him. And I think that just came over a year of, you know, when he first let us into his apartment, it was, you know, incredible. No one had ever been in his apartment, maybe one or two people. And to have a camera in there, it was, you know, and we had no idea who his neighbors were. We had no idea that there was this sort of eviction issue with Carnegie Hall that came about over time.
All of that surfaced as we were making the movie, you know.
And actually, the way we met his neighbors, it was 4 months of us begging him to let us follow him at night. And he finally said, okay, you can follow me tonight. Meet me downstairs in my apartment. So we get the cameras and we meet him.
All three of us had bikes. So the three of us were there with our bicycles waiting for Bill.
In the freezing cold outside.
In the freezing cold.
And he comes outside and he says, you know, the parties aren't so good tonight, so instead of coming with me to the parties, you should meet my neighbor.
The Duchess of, he said, have you ever met the Duchess? And we, no, the Duchess of Carnegie Hall.
And we're just thinking, and I'm thinking, oh my God, he's dumping us on his neighbor? Who wants to meet his neighbor? But we had the cameras, and so we go upstairs, and lo and behold, it's Adita, who's amazing.
Adita Sherman,
and he opened up this whole other storyline in the film.
Right.
So he actually gave us a gift in doing that. We didn't realize it at the time. We thought he was just dumping us.
Right.
So it was like that. That's
part of his charm.
That's part of his charm, exactly.
Yes, exactly.
That he would dump you.
Yeah.
And he would give you something great out of it.
And that was a real window onto, you know, the way he lived his life, his entire sensibility. You know, Carnegie Hall turned out to be, and we had some vague idea about this, but it turns out to be, you know, kind of the Uptown Chelsea Hotel. I mean, it's you know, it's really a pantheon of arts and letters who lived there over the course of a century. And, you know, and Bill was right there, like living with all of them. And they you know, their daily lives were all about art making in all of its respective mediums. And so that became a part of the movie, and it became a part of, you know,
the kind of lost bohemia.
Exactly.
You know, yeah. That really doesn't exist or is dying in New York. You know, these people just represented something that was so important.
Well, there's also that feeling of like it holding on to not becoming Grey Gardens.
Yeah.
You know, that element. Well,
there's
like
a little bit of that.
You can feel the wine there, and it's a little dangerous and yet interesting.
Actually, Bill joked one day, the camera wasn't running, but he actually joked one day, what are you making Grey Gardens? I mean, he actually made a joke about it.
But, you know, that's another component of the film. You know, it's not called Bill Cunningham New York for no reason. I mean, part of it is about kind of a dying culture in New York as well. And you see that happening. I mean, the you know, his having to move from Carnegie Hall and those last six residents of Carnegie Hall, all of whom are artists, had to leave. You know, it says something about New York at this moment in time and a New York that we knew and loved dearly. That we think it's kind of like an elegy to New York, to that part of New York.
Well, the movie plays differently than I think people expect when they hear the tagline or the, you know, a log line about the movie. It's like, it's really not just about a guy who works, you know, who works in the New York Times or is in fashion maven or whatever it is. It really is something else. And I think that's why it's probably been touching audiences, because it seems to connect with audiences in a way that's more than the sum of its parts, I guess, in some way. Have you found that? Thank you.
No, I think Bill, there's something about Bill that's touching people, and that's what I tried to capture, you know, his spirit, his way of living, his values. And I think in a certain way, you know, it's kind of we're in a moment in time where, you know, the economy is collapsing and everybody's just obsessed with material things and obsessed with fame and being on camera, and here's this guy who is saying the opposite. He's saying, you don't need money. You don't need all that ego gratification. You don't, you know, these are other values that could make you happy. Mm-hmm. And I think people are responding to that in a certain way. You know?
When he's looking, you know, he is one of the most reluctant fashion deities on the planet, you know, and there's an interesting contradiction, I think, in the movie, you know, and he even cites it himself, that here he loves all of these, you know, women in these, you know, fabulous clothes, and you know, and yet he lives such a simple monastic existence. And yet it's not that he's not interested in labels, he's not interested in brands in terms
or
of
status.
Or status in terms of clothing. He's interested in originality. Mm-hmm. And that's what he's looking for all the time, is originality. And, you know, and he does it with a kind of dedication, a kind of rigor, and a kind of joy, and he brings real passion to it, and it's pure. And I think that, I mean, if anything, that's what I think transcends, you know, the subject matter of our movie. I think he reaches people. I mean, we've come to see that. We didn't know that was going to actually happen. I mean, we had no idea this movie was going to play outside of New York, because he is kind of a fixture in New York City, but we had no idea that it would touch people.
So it was just a kind of an interesting guy who you wanted or interested in, so therefore, let's make
a touched movie. He touched us, and it was the reasons that people are responding are the same reasons that we wanted to make the movie. Mm-hmm. And it's just really gratifying that, like, people are responding
that
in the way that happened, that people are responding for the same reason that we wanted to make the movie, you know. But I think it's true. He has a purity of spirit. And I think why he's so respected in the fashion world is that he has no agenda. He's not looking for fame. He's not looking to curry favor with anybody. He's not looking to gain anything. So what he's documenting comes from this very pure, true place. He's a fashion historian, and people respect his opinion. He has this amazing wealth of knowledge, and it's just this pure documentation, and I think people respect that.
And he wants, you know, all he wants is the freedom to do what he does. You know, he develops his pages himself. Nobody assigns him. Mm-hmm. They are completely self-generated. And that's what he loves more than anything. And he just wants the freedom to be able to do that. And that's inspirational. I mean, that's what everybody wants. Yeah.
Well, does the culture of the times affect who you guys are and how you see the world at this point, having been a part of it over a long period of time?
I don't know. I mean, I don't know what to say.
Of course.
About that.
You
know,
I would say, I mean, obviously.
It's so much a part of our lives, just having the paper in our lives. We, you know, it's something that we read all the time. It's, you know, it's...
I mean, yes, I can say absolutely. I mean, it made me kind of aim for a more objective view of the world. You know, I have enormous respect for its integrity. You know, it really is after the truth, such as that may be. And believe me, you know, we can you know, contemplate the nature of that forever. But but I think it is quite sincere in its attempt to kind of achieve a certain objectivity, whether it does or not. That's not for me to say. But I think that I certainly got that, you know, that ethic being there. Absolutely.
Because if Bill wasn't so monastic, if he wasn't what he is, it's almost like he couldn't do what he does because it would be bastardized by another dinner and another label and another person trying to pay him off.
Exactly. I mean, Bill has taken a vow of fashion. He's like a priest. Yes. It's like this almost a religious calling for him. Yeah. And he happens to have this amazing platform at the New York Times, and they allow him the freedom to do whatever he wants to do in that context. But I think it's true. I think that, you know, people look to his columns because they understand that it is pure, that it has not been bought off in any way. I mean, you know, we were living at the New York Times for a year making this movie, and his desk is piled with stuff that people send to him, and he's always giving it away or returning it. I mean, he won't accept anything, you know, because he really, for him, his moral compass is so strong, and he really lives by it.
We've become so micro in the business that, you know, everything is a detail and what's happening this week and then next week doesn't matter. And it seems like his whole energy is about having a macro view, that he, you know, picks up a trend on a street and he's the first one to see it. And it's not like, you know, somebody else is writing about it, so he's filling it in with pictures. He's the one who's seeing the thing happen.
He can also take that trend that he sees right now and apply it to what happened in 1924. And, you know, in terms of being a fashion historian, he really knows and understands, you know, the nature of fabrics and patterns and how people have worn clothes for over the centuries. So so even though he's observing something that's completely new today, he can always, you know, draw on the past and say, oh, well, look at this that took place in 1897. And, you know, and that's brilliant. I mean, there's a kind of, I mean, he's really wise in terms of an understanding of fashion. He doesn't take it at its most superficial level at all. Yeah. And that's an interesting thing.
Well, the value of institutional memory has been completely disregarded by, you know, the authoritative voice has been kind of like diminished in the last decade. It's kind of the downside of the internet so far.
Yeah.
Hopefully it'll evolve.
I mean, and the other thing about Bill's work is that his body of work, I think, transcends, you know, just merely what people are wearing on the street. He's been documenting, as Philip says, you know, the intersection of fashion and culture and society in New York for the past 50 years. Yeah. And it goes beyond like what people are wearing. It's, you know, he's documented every Easter parade since 1960, every gay pride parade, every Halloween parade. So he's been documenting a city and how people live. So if you want to know what New York was like in the latter half of the 20th century, into the 21st, you would look at Bill's photographs. I mean, so his body of work is really significant in terms of it's like cultural anthropology, you know.
And also in terms of the history of photography, and that's another, you know, aspect of what Bill does that interests me in particular. I mean, this is a chronicle of that intersection of fashion and society, and not unlike, and this might sound like a reach, but what Aceh did in the 19th century for Paris, the streets of Paris and the buildings of the Ancien Régime, you know, that is an amazing documentation and chronicle. I mean, it's also poetic. Mm-hmm. Well, what Bill has done is not unlike that in terms of its forensic record he has left of this, you know, of life in New York over the last half century. It's important.
And the irony is that he doesn't even consider himself a photographer. Right. He would think that would be pretentious.
Right. Right.
You know, or he thinks of himself as a reporter.
Right.
And he just uses the camera, mm-hmm. you know, as a reporter would use a pen to pick, right. to make notes.
And it's not that his pictures in and of themselves individually are brilliant, but collectively mm-hmm. they are. And the way he puts them together on a weekly basis in a grid adds up to something that's conceptually very, very large and interesting.
Yeah, it's an ongoing interesting battle, and again, it leaks over into everything else in journalism and writing and how people, you know, whether it's about punctuation or about meaning or about art, you know, all those elements of how people value things are fascinating. Is there a way to engage all of his work in a broader spectrum that hasn't happened yet or may happen? Or
well, we're trying to convince him to leave it to an institution of note that will know how to preserve it, catalog it, and make it available to mm-hmm. You know, scholars and curators and other designers and all of that. So
we don't know how seriously he takes it.
Yes, I mean, we have been pushing him for the last 2 years to do that because he mm-hmm. is 83 right now, and you know, he maintains, you know, oh well, if I die, you know, my family will just come and throw it all in the street. And so he jokes about it that way, yeah. but I actually think he has taken steps to make sure that it will be taken care of.
We almost think at that age and the kind of life he lives that if you start thinking about preserving it or what the history is or whatever, your legacy, that you lose that impetus, you lose that
yes,
energy
exactly.
moving yeah. forward.
Yeah. And he doesn't want to think about it. He's yeah. so much in the moment and today, you know, yeah. living today.
It's really true. I mean, he really works like a 20-year-old.
Yeah.
I mean, he works yeah. 24 hours a day, every yeah. day. That's really all he does. Yeah. And his level of energy is astonishing. I mean, he exhausted us.
This is so hilarious.
I mean, really.
You know, it took us, months to convince him to let us follow him around, as I said, in, mm-hmm. you know, in evening hours. And so Richard and Tony did follow him on his bicycle all yeah. uptown, downtown, on this kind of jerry-rigged adult tricycle, literally. Yeah. And so they followed him from downtown all the way uptown to the Museum of Natural History and then across the park to some other party. And by 11 o'clock at night, they were completely wiped out.
I was begging him to slow down. I was begging him to stop. And he loved it.
He loved it. He came in the next morning.
Oh, you kids.
He came in the next morning and he said to me, it's like, I tired out Richard Richard. He calls me Philippe and Richard. But he said, I tired out Richard and Tony last night. They couldn't follow me and I was going for another 2 hours. And he thought it was hilarious.
And I'm twice their age. Yeah. What's wrong with that?
He's a triathlete.
Essentially, yeah.
But he has, I mean, the other thing about the way he lives his life, the simplicity of it, he has pared everything down so that he can do nothing but his work. Mm-hmm. That's all he wants to do. And I mean, that's inspiring, you know?
So how was the experience for you guys in terms of becoming filmmakers? Was that different? Was it shocking? Was it?
Richard has been a filmmaker.
But I mean, it sounds like this film kind of came together in a different way than you would normally make another film.
Yeah.
Yes.
How did that make sense to you ultimately? Did it change as you went along?
Well, I think if anything, what this making this movie this way taught me is that you don't need the perfect situation to make a film. I mean, I think technology is there where you don't need the perfect budget and you don't need the perfect, you know, crew. I mean, this movie was made with like four people, you know? And so I just think it really was very freeing to me to be able to see that, hey, you know, there's a camera. Like, if you really have a script or a documentary subject, mm-hmm. make your movie. It was really liberating in that sense.
And how was editing for you?
Editing was wonderful. Mm-hmm. I had two wonderful editors, Ryan Denmark and Barry Alexander Brown. Mm-hmm. And it was we spent a year in the editing room. So the movie really was made, I would say, in the editing room. And we had shot maybe, probably, two-thirds of the film by the time we got in the editing room. And mm-hmm. so as we started constructing the story, I realized what I needed to shoot. And so, but the process was great. It was wonderful.
And in the cut is really when the structure evolved? There wasn't really an idea even, or you couldn't, was there a clear notion of what you thought you had or where you thought you were or at the point where you went into cutting?
I actually feel like it happened, it was an evolution. You know, I knew there was, as I was shooting, I was seeing threads of potential storylines, but it really wasn't until I got all the footage in the room and we started playing with it that it started to emerge. Because in a way, the movie is structured almost like one of Bill's pages. It's a collage.
Yes.
You know, I mean, I think there is a strong narrative, emotional thread, because there's no story, essentially.
Right.
You know, but there is this, there is a definite arc, and there's an emotional journey that I feel proud of that we really worked at. Yeah. I mean, it was a year in the editing room creating that, but that was something that just we discovered as, you know, as I was in the editing room.
I mean, there's a saying that documentaries are written in the editing room, and I think that really is true with this, you know. At the beginning, what was shot, I mean, there were certain elements of his life that we knew that we had to cover, or his work, rather, right. Not even his life, and that was just kind of a given, and we did that, and it was from that that you then decided, oh, as you're piecing it together, God, we really need to go out and shoot him doing this, and we really need to interview him about this. And so it was piecemeal in that regard, but I think that's a normal part of a documentary process.
Well, was there another film at 6 months that you thought was the film that changed 6 months later, or was...
No, it was actually, like, there was a trajectory. We felt like we were going down this road that we were discovering, and the pieces were, like, falling into place, you know, and I think I kind of knew, okay, the movie, we knew he was being evicted, so I had a sense that, you know, maybe was one of the threads that had to end the film, you know, and so, but it was really kind of great because I feel like the material was dictating it. You know, I wasn't trying to impose something on the material, and that was really kind of a revelation to me, you know, that to trust the material and just trust your instincts and don't be afraid to let it go where it needs to go, you know.
But I think what you were also doing in that process of editing was aiming for and achieving an emotional tenor, which was a very subtle thing. And, you know, it's not so much rewriting the story as you were editing. It's really kind of aiming for that emotional tenor that I think, you know, is a very subtle kind of, you know, inarticulable thing.
And is there a great feeling of pressure in a situation like this, where you guys kind of the art world and of the mindset that, you know, we'll get it done as it comes together, it's all coming together, or are you feeling like, oh my God, why isn't it done yet? I need to get to a festival.
No. I actually knew. I mean, I knew that it was going to take about a year. I mean, I just knew. Mm-hmm. And so I guess we had the luxury of time. I mean, I knew that we knew that we wanted to be finished by a year.
Right.
And so... But it was never like, oh, we want to get into a festival. I mean, we would never compromise the movie to try to do that. You know, we also didn't want to, I mean, Bill is so interesting and we actually felt like, oh, we could film this guy forever.
Right.
You know, I mean, the only thing that
apparently he felt you were.
And he did. He did. So no, I just, we have the time to really make the movie that we wanted to make.
And when did you realize that you had made a movie that was going to reach beyond the, you know, the intimate world that he is part of normally?
It's interesting. When Ryan and I were cutting the movie and we finished the movie, I kind of felt like, oh, it works. Like I felt like, well, whatever we achieved works, but I also didn't know what the response was going to be. I just felt like we had a movie that worked in from our point of view. What we set out to do. And then we started showing it to people and the response was really wonderful. And that was really gratifying. But I think the thing that actually changed our perception of the reach of the film is when it played in Australia.
Yes.
Because it won audience awards at the Sydney Film Festival and Melbourne for Best Doc. And they didn't even know who he was. Right. So that was like a moment where we thought like, oh.
Yeah.
This movie is about something other than knowing who Bill Cunningham is in New York. It's reaching people in a different way. So I think that was the first.
That was the moment of kind of revelation for us. You know, it sort of achieved what we were after in a way. You know?
And when you started this journey, I assume you thought Oscar immediately was your first goal.
I just wanted to learn how to turn on the camera. We weren't thinking that at all. I mean, I was just like, how do I work this focus on this camera? I had never shot a movie before. So that was what I was thinking about.
This is so the little documentary that could, you know, I mean, we had no ambition.
I don't know, ambition,
but that was not on our minds at all. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was really the practical day to day. How do we get Bill to do this? How do we get this particular kind of equipment? You know, oh my God, how do we get some more money? All of that.
Oh my God, he's dropping out of the film. How do we get him back into the movie?
On a daily basis. Yeah. I mean, it was not an easy, effortless journey in that regard. Yeah. It was really, you know, all of the issues that come up in movie making were there all the time.
And the movie was made for no money. I mean, I joke we were like our own slave to the movie. Right. I mean, there were no assistants or... No. You know, a
like
friend.
Bill.
Oh. Yeah, I mean, friends of ours see the movie, and they're, you know, filmmaker friends of ours see the movie, and they watch the end credits, and they, like, this is the shortest end credits I've ever seen in a movie. How did you do this? You
know? We had literally four people making this movie total. Mm-hmm. That's pretty much it. I mean, you know, and I mean, I was the producer, but I was the, you know, gopher all the time.
The only thing only way it could have been made, though, it seems like.
Yeah, and that was actually the pleasure of it in a certain way. You know, it really was. Just all of us doing this thing, and it was fun and crazy.
So was there a moment where the film was around and you felt like, okay, now this is the experience, we've had it, we've done a great thing, we're happy, we're satisfied, you know, everything else from now is gravy? Or are you still enjoying each, you know, thing and expecting more? Is there any past your surpassed your expectations to such a degree that...
It's just all delicious. We're just so pleased with it. You know, we don't have any expectations. We're just really just enjoying, like, everything that's happening. It's
very gratifying that it has a life in the world and that people are responsive to the film. Yeah. It's just gratifying.
And you've started on to your next film.
Starting on to my next film, which is a narrative. I'm really a narrative filmmaker. So my next film is a narrative film that I wrote the script for, and I'll be directing, and so just trying to put that together. And
do share.
It's called The Farnsworth House, and it's about the architect Mies van der Rohe. It's a true story based on, he had a very scandalous relationship with one of his clients, Edith Farnsworth, and they went from being lovers to bitter enemies. They sued each other, but out of this relationship came The Farnsworth House, which is the first glass house ever built. So the movie's really about all the blood on the floor and the making of this masterpiece.
And not throwing rocks.
No. So it's sex in architecture.
So did this Bill Cunningham New York help you on getting that movie funded?
It seems like it's helping.
So you're feeling an industry embrace as well, not just the love of a culture?
Yeah, yeah.
So is that gratifying for you, that you've been part of that journey?
Well, it's all been gratifying for me, but I am... not on the journey with him in the making of The Farnsworth House. I'm going back to being my earnest little writer self, and you know, so I want to complete my biography of Sam Wagstaff. And
Philip produced this movie because really it was the only way that it would have happened.
Right.
You know, he had never produced a film before, but it just had to be, you know, this intimate family affair. And
I did it out of love and admiration for Bill and love and admiration for Richard.
Oh, thank you.